stand together. Everybody all over the room. Let's sing this song together. Of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Well, if you ask me where I come from, here's what I tell everyone. I was born by God's dear grace in an extraordinary place, where the stars and stripes and the eagle flies. Well, it's a big old land with countless dreams, and happiness isn't out of reach. Hard work pays off just like it should. I've seen enough to know that we've got it good.
Where the stars and stripes and the eagle flies, there's a lady that stands in the harbor for what we believe. And there's a bell that still echoes with Christ that it calls to.
No, it ain't the only place on earth, but it's the only place that I prefer. To love my wife and raise our kids, yeah, it's the same way that my daddy did.
Where the stars and stripes and the eagle fly, there's a stands in the harbor for what we believe. And there's a bell that still echoes the price that it costs to be free. There's a lady that stands in the harbor for what we believe. And there's a bell and stripes and the eagle flies, with the stars and stripes and the eagle
be a citizen of these United States of America. It truly is an exceptional nation, a country that has been abundantly and richly blessed. It's no wonder why many of us well up with emotion and pride when we see the American flag, our symbol of freedom, as it waves majestically in the wind. It's why some of us can't help but stare when we see a soldier in uniform. They remind us of the sacrifice that continues to be made on our behalf and the price it costs for preserving the freedom we all enjoy. Yes, we are. We are proud to be called Americans. But there's a great host of us that are even more proud to be called Christians. For we believe that true freedom, liberty, justice, and prosperity come from a sovereign God who gave us principles by which to govern our lives and to govern our society. It may seem a little strange to us today to combine a person's patriotism with Christianity, but not in the minds of our founding fathers. George Washington, the first president, said, "To the distinguished character of patriot, it should be our highest glory to add the more distinguished character of Christian." The father of our country felt comfortable intertwining American patriotism with Christianity. Although many of our modern historians would like to rewrite or alter America's past, there is overwhelming evidence that a majority of the founding fathers were believers in Jesus Christ. Of the 56 men who signed the Declaration of Independence, 50 of them were regular church attenders. 29 of them had seminary degrees. We only need to read the personal writings of these men to gain a clear understanding of the integral part the Bible played in our beginnings and the spiritual foundation upon which this great nation was built. Charles Carroll, one of the signers of the Declaration of Independence, said, "I am grateful to Almighty God for the blessing through Jesus Christ our Lord He's conferred upon my beloved country." Benjamin Rush, another signer, also known as the father of American medicine, said, "The gospel of Jesus Christ prescribes the wisest rules for just conduct in every situation of life." Francis Hopkinson, another signer, was one of the first federal judges appointed by George Washington. He was a church music director and a church organist and wrote America's first purely American hymnal. John Witherspoon, president of Princeton University and signer of the Declaration of Independence, said, "I entreat you in the most earnest manner to believe in Jesus Christ, for there is no salvation in any other. If you are not reconciled to God through Jesus Christ, if you're not clothed with the spotless robe of His righteousness, you must forever perish. These are the founders of this nation." Patrick Henry, the man who cried, "Give me liberty or give me death," said, "It cannot be emphasized too strongly or too often that this great nation was founded not by religionists, but by Christians, not on religions, but on the gospel of Jesus Christ." These great patriots, and many more like them, were statesmen, men of character and integrity. They possessed a great faith in God and in adhering to biblical principles for the betterment of all mankind. They affixed their names to the Declaration of Independence, which is the foundational document of our government. From this great foundation, they constructed the Constitution of the United States. These documents were the beginnings of what would produce the greatest nation in all of history. But our greatness is not because of our might or our intellect. America is exceptional because we adopted certain principles from our beginning that God was able to bless. Our second president, John Adams, he said, "The general principles on which the fathers achieved independence were the principles of Christianity." Our seventh president, Andrew Jackson, said, "The Bible is the rock on which our republic rests." This is probably going to amaze most of you in here, but did you know the first Bible printed in the English language in America was printed with United States congressional approval? It happened in 1782. In the records, it states that the Holy Scriptures were printed for use in our schools. For the next 320 years, the Bible was part of public education. It has only been the last 60 years that the courts decided to remove the Bible from our public schools. Abraham Lincoln said, the philosophy of the schoolroom in one generation will be the philosophy of government in the next. Somewhere, my friends, we along the way left the God of our fathers. Instead of following the biblical path of our founders, we trusted in our own wisdom, replacing the perfect, unchanging laws of God with laws of our own making. We now, as a nation, find ourselves morally bankrupt, financially in a mess, and full of corruption. I wonder if we realize how dangerously close we are to losing the America that we love. Abraham Lincoln prophetically warned, America will never be destroyed from outside. If we falter and lose our freedoms, it will be because we destroyed ourselves. But I've got news this morning. There's a remnant of believers across this nation who still believe God can rescue and God can still save, and that righteousness exalts a nation and sin is a reproach to any people. We can no longer sit around and complain about our political leaders. We must rise up and sound the alarm from the church house to the White House. It's time to cry out to God on our behalf of our nation, to ask Him to forgive us, to cleanse us, and to heal our land. God can heal the soul of our nation. He can change the hearts of men and women. There is hope for our children. With mercy and love, our Heavenly Father calls out to us, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. This is not in the script, but I really feel like it would be right to recognize those of you that have served in some form or capacity in one of our armed services, armed forces. Would you stand if you've been in Army, Navy, Air Force, Marines, Coast Guard? Just stand to your feet right now in the choir. Come on now, let's thank these men and women. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. By the way, are there any police, first responders, anyone here? Can we thank them right now for what they do for you and me every single day? I'm grateful for them. Many in our nation believe that faith and politics are two completely separate entities. They are not. And our founding fathers understood this. They believe and they built our system of governing knowing these two important things. Number one, we, mankind, we are not perfect. We are drawn to power, to greed, and to pride. We have tendencies to misrepresent the truth, and create false narratives. We want to win at all costs. We always have, and we always will. And because of this, our founders built a system of checks and balances, separation of powers, equal justice. Not a pure democracy, but a constitutional republic, predicated on the fact that our rights and our freedoms come from God, not from government. Secondly, our founders believed, and they said it time and time again, that the viability of our system relied on religious faith. John Adams wrote, "Our Constitution was made for a moral and religious people. It wholly is inadequate to the government of anything else." James Madison wrote that our Constitution requires sufficient virtue among men for self-government. Otherwise, nothing less than the chains of despotism can restrain them from destroying and devouring one another. What are we doing right now? Charlie Kirk, founder of Turning Point USA, said, "There are two things we Christians have in common. Number one, we believe in God. And number two, you're not Him." And when you believe those two things, it shapes your government views. It shapes your political views. It shapes your philosophical views. Kirk says, if we do not reverse the direction we are now headed, we're going to see something that will be so unrecognizable, so horrific. So for all the doubters who say, I'm sick and tired of the Bible and religion and your God, let me remind you, you live in a civilization that was founded by courageous and religious people. You live in a civilization where the Bible is the basis of it all. Maybe instead of scoffing at it, you open up a history book and understand that the Bible and Judeo-Christian values built the greatest civilization that ever existed. Yeah, you can clap. We must never forget that the freedoms that we have enjoyed all through our lives have been under attack from outside our borders as well as from within. The first settlers came to America because they longed for freedom and liberty. They were fleeing religious persecution and economic oppression. Concerning those founding fathers, President Ronald Reagan said this: their courage created a nation built on a universal claim to human dignity, on the proposition that every man, woman, and child had a right to a future of freedom. Freedom of religion, freedom of speech, freedom of enterprise, freedom of assembly, freedom of the press, the right to bear arms, the right to petition the government. These guaranteed freedoms make the people of the United States of America the freest in the entire world. I'm thankful that God let me be born in the United States of America. How about you? Are you thankful for this country? My country, 'tis of the steady
land of liberty, of thee I sing. Land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrims' pride, from every mountainside.
May be seated.
built freedom into every fiber of creation. And he meant for us to all be free.
Seated. Pastor Jeff LeBorg, Pastor Fairview Knox, would you make your way right now? Let's welcome him as he comes right now. Pastor Jeff.
Well, good morning. I hate we can't do an encore of that. I'm just telling you, time won't permit. But thank you, Brother Mike, choir, instrumentalists and all. Welcome to Freedom Rally 2022. On behalf of this faith family called Fairview Knox, we want to welcome you to our campus, and we want to thank you for taking time out of your day to pause for a moment to not only recount the freedom we have, but to very intentionally pray that the Lord preserve this very unique and beautiful experience of freedom that we have in this nation. We are blessed as a church family to host Freedom Rally 2022. And I have the privilege of loving, leading, and serving this great church called Fairview Knox. And specifically this morning, it is an honor that I get to serve Tim and Robin Harris. We're very glad that you're here to help us celebrate this great country and to rally unapologetically the heart cry that this nation would return to the God of her fathers. Freedom Rally is
the brainchild. It was birthed in the heart of Tim Harris, the founder of Knoxville Wholesale Furniture. Tim's motivation is very simple. It is to remind us of the freedoms this nation has enjoyed from its earliest beginnings and the role that faith has played in our nation's unprecedented historical success. Not success simply to enjoy the fruits of our labor. Knoxville Wholesale Furniture is the epitome. It is the living, breathing illustration of what it means to be a nation that has been set free to pursue through hard work, through faith, through family, the ability not to gather goods that they may be spoiled on ourselves. Anyone that knows Knoxville Wholesale Furniture and the success that they enjoy knows that they are the very definition and illustration of the American dream being lived out in the pursuit of life and liberty and happiness. But this is what you need to know about Knoxville Wholesale Furniture as they celebrate their 30th year this year. Congratulations. Will you give the Lord praise and a little bit of appreciation? 30 years. Now I want you to notice something. Instead of a big celebration that would have been plastered in newspapers and ads, which is not inappropriate, it was the heart of this family and Tim Harris specifically, that this day be set aside in a house of worship to do something to first and foremost honor his employees, to make a greater impact on this community that he has so richly blessed, and to encourage his fellow industry friends and leaders by lifting up unapologetically his Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I don't have to tell you that it is a true statement, though some may think this is a bit beyond decorum for this moment. It would be said of Tim Harris, you better not ask him what he thinks, because he will tell you. Now, for all of you that know him, you know that's a true statement. But can I say something from a personal perspective as his pastor and one who sits at his feet to learn from him as a leader? I am thankful that he's not only a man that you better not ask him what he thinks, because he will tell you. I'm thankful that he's a man that you don't have to ask him, because by conviction, he will share with you God has blessed his business and that he is firmly, unapologetically a follower of Jesus Christ. I am thankful for that, Tim Harris. Knoxville Wholesale Furniture is the very epitome of this real success. They are constantly making an impact on communities and churches, on those who go to the very front lines of crises and traumas and natural disasters. In fact, let me give you a couple of examples. This year alone, they have given over $300,000 to various charitable organizations. In 2021, when everyone was running to play the political correctness card in defund the police movement, Knoxville Wholesale Furniture took a stand and publicly gave $100,000 to support the police and first responders across our community. When others were bashing those who protect our life and our property, Tim Harris was leading publicly and unapologetically the fact that our communities, the very civilization that we enjoy, are those who put on a badge and put their life on the line every day. Last month alone, they gave $100,000 to the Honor Guard to help their effort in saying thank you for those in their labor of love that celebrate the life of those who have given their life that we might live in liberty. During the pandemic, at a time when most in this nation had shut down their businesses and were hiding behind fear and doubt, Knoxville Wholesale Furniture gave $250,000 to Samaritan's Purse. Giving that, I want you to understand, this gift at a time when businesses were reeling and running in fear, Knoxville Wholesale Furniture stepped out by faith, not knowing what the future held, and gave $250,000 along with another $250,000 to Samaritan's Purse because they were on the front lines helping those who were in the most severe lockdown and scenarios of sickness during the pandemic. Over the past 10 years, Knoxville Wholesale Furniture has given back to this community over $4 million. Wow. But do you know, if you were to ask Brother Tim, in fact, I know this because I've heard him say this. Of all of the money they've invested, of the industry that they've impacted, of all of the lives that they've blessed that nobody's ever known about, if you were to ask him what his greatest accomplishment in this life is, it is the Bible study that they hold at their warehouse over the last 2 decades, where dozens upon dozens have come to know Jesus Christ. That's his greatest accomplishment. So, without further ado, Brother Tim, I want to say to you, as I make you welcome to this helm, I want to thank you not just for the financial impact you've had on your community, your church, and untold souls for the kingdom. I want to thank you for your heart, for loving us, challenging us, and being bold enough to tell us the truth, even when we don't want to hear it. Will you make welcome Mr. Tim Harris, founder and chairman of Knoxville Wholesale Furniture.
That applause needs to be for our phenomenal 175 employees that made all this possible. I didn't do this. This is our people. And I never took a business class or an accounting class. I was a football coach with a PE major, graduated from Portland High School with a 1.93 GPA. And that was really good because all I cared about was girls and football, so to achieve that 1.93 was a big feat. But what I learned coaching was you invest in people. And when we started, we had an ugly building. We didn't have the right furniture lines. We didn't even have enough money or anything, but we invested in people. And in our industry, many times leaders in our industry walk by and ignore or don't motivate the biggest thing they have, the biggest asset, which is people. So thanks to everybody that works for us. And they're the ones that make this possible, not me. We're here today to create influence, to motivate you to make a difference. And anybody can do that. And if we don't do it before long, we're going to lose the country. That's very evident. We have, when you go down and you just hear the education that was laid out to hear by Brother Mike, you see how far we've fallen. We have fallen so far. But we want everybody to gain courage from this and inspiration to know that you can matter in your home, in your business, wherever you may be at your church. You need to reach out and be influenced to others. We all know that the country's going in the wrong direction, without a doubt. If Joe Biden had run for election and said, I'm going to raise everybody's taxes 30%, I don't think you'd been elected. And that's what he did. Most people, our great county mayor, Glenn Jacobs, is here today, and he's going to do a much better job than me. But we know in our area here that most income levels are 30 to 75,000. Inflation's not 8%. On the things you buy, like gas, food, rent, the things that really matter to struggling families, over 2 years incremental, it's up 30%. It's taking all of your disposable income. And this is all self-imposed. These are terrible policies, starting with our energy policy. And I don't want to educate some of you, and I'm going to spend a lot of time, but you need to know. When we shut down and we inhibit our energy policy, everything arrives by truck. And that was the kickoff of massive inflation. We also had crazy shutdown policies. Our mayor fought hard to keep our schools open and do things. These shutdown policies that our federal government had created the supply chain issues. The factories were shut down. People couldn't work. The overspending, as announced yesterday, we're now $31 trillion with a T in debt. Let me tell you what that means. They're raising interest rates right now. When interest rates climb to about 7, 7.5, 8%, the interest on our debt will be almost $1 trillion. If we bring in 4 or 5 trillion, we're going to give $1 trillion of it away we can't even use to interest on our debt. These people that have done this to the country, I really don't know what to say about them. The environmental crazies. I heard this. I couldn't believe I got to hear this 2 days ago. It was so wonderful. We have spent on all of this environmental stuff as a country $3.9 trillion. Now here's what we got back. We used to be 82% dependent on gas and oil and coal. We've for $3.9 trillion, we moved it to 81. That's how crazy this is. I was having lunch with the mayor last Friday, and he's talked to the people at TVA. If only 30% of everybody in our community had an electric car, it would blow our power grid up. These are the crazy things that have been proposed and put on TV constantly, propagandizing our community. Crime, out of control, every record. And you see these cities like Chicago and New York and Philadelphia and Los Angeles where this goes on a daily basis, a weekly. 15 killed, 20 killed, 187 shot. This needs to be said. Who runs those cities? Liberal, socialist, Democrats. And if you're a Democrat today, just repent. I grew up in a Democratic, it needed to be said. We voted for Buford Ellington growing up. I grew up in a Democratic family. I didn't leave them, they left me. And the Democratic Party today is not the party it used to be. It's been taken over by these radical socialists. These are the people that wanted to defund the police. These are the people that run these big cities for years, and they're decaying and falling apart. The border. We don't have a border, but yet we have a president who says the border's secure. Just get up and lie. Millions and millions of people. It's not free. They overtake the hospitals. They overtake the schools. How'd you like to be a second grade teacher and you thought you were going to have 25, now you got 40, 15 of them don't speak English? You think that's fun? This isn't free, guys. That border, that border's not run by our government or our military or our border patrol. It was designated 2 weeks ago as the deadliest border in the world. The cartels run it, and they make 2 to 3, heard this on TV this morning, 200 to 300 million a week. People save their whole life in Guatemala, their whole life, pay these guys $8,000 to bring them across the border. Then they sell the young girls into sex slavery, prostitution, drugs. If we had a war going on somewhere, and we were having 50, 100,000 people killed a year, people would be storming the Capitol. We have over 100,000 die every year from fentanyl coming across that border, and we do nothing about it. Foreign affairs. You know, we had one of our own here in Corrington. Ryan. Killed over the just ridiculous pullout of Afghanistan, the way that was handled. Who in the world, it's even destroying our military, that they would, you know that the military wouldn't do this, but they were told, take the troops out first. We left $80 billion of equipment that you paid for with your taxes over there, being sold all over the world to terrorists on the black market. And these people are doing a good job. They're doing a horrible job. And we've got to be salt and light to point these things out. And we've got to be leaders to say, influence other people to turn this around. You see how the country was founded. You see where it is today. Do you think we've got a problem? We've got a major problem. And if people don't get busy, that's what this is about. I didn't have to do this. But we need to motivate each other to be an influence, salt and light, and be leaders in our community, our company, and everywhere else. More importantly than these things is our rejection of the Bible. We're all imperfect. We all sin. Even those that are us are, that are saved believers. But the rejection of the Bible and these principles is destroying the country, and that's even more important. You need to vote the Bible. You understand that? You need to vote the Bible. You need to look at candidates and say, which guy is the closest thing to what we would aspire to be if we could be perfect, okay? You need to vote the Bible. And you need a firm foundation of which to garner those beliefs. We've become a country to where one political party, their number one issue is abortion, killing babies. You know the Sanger lady that started this? These abortion clinics were started to eliminate the black race. These people were racist in the beginning. Planned Parenthood. That's the Democrats' number one issue. Kill babies all the way up. You ever seen a baby an hour after it's born? Precious. Wait, let's go back an hour, 1 minute before birth. Let's kill it. There was even a crazy woman in California in the state assembly who put forth a bill saying in the first 24 days after birth, you can kill it. Now, maybe we need to extend that to 18. That might be good. We've seen some young... No, I'm just kidding. But can you believe we have sunk that low? Can't pray in school, but we can have transgender drag queens read to second graders. But you can't pray. We should be teaching people to love their neighbor, but all that's ever on TV is something to divide the races, to turn blacks against whites, and vice versa. That's what we see. I grew up in the real civil rights movement with Martin Luther King, great man of courage. This thing today, no. This thing today is not about civil rights. This thing today is about turning us against each other, and it needs to stop. Instead of liberty and freedom, we want to censor people, do away with their right to free speech, especially Christians. Instead of lifting up young girls and giving them confidence, we let boys go into their sports and dominate them, and then afterwards go into the dressing room with them. Now, these things 15 years ago, you'd have said that can never happen. Why did this happen? Did you know in the last mayoral election, Glenn Jacobs was favored by 30% because he's done a great job? And, but guess what we did? A lot of you didn't vote. He only won by 10 points. At what point will you fight? At what point will you be an influence when it's too late? We've got to get serious about this. We used to say, oh, that'll happen in 20 or 30 years. No, it's happening now. It's happening now, and we've got to turn it around. Instead of free enterprise, we teach and preach socialism and communism which both hate Christianity. And I hear these people talking about how horrible our country is. Do you know God used the United States of America to take the gospel all over the world? If we've not done another thing, that was incredible. Our free enterprise system has lifted millions and billions out of poverty all over the world. Sometime when you get a chance, go back and listen to Rush Limbaugh's story of the Pilgrims. First year they came over, they were kind of socialists. They're all in there together, and some of them are working, some of them aren't. And the ones that are working are mad at the ones that aren't. And after a year or two, about starving to death, he says, hey, this year you can keep 2 acres for yourself. And you can tend that and sell it or keep it or whatever you want to do. And boom, free enterprise started spreading around the world. That was the act that did that. That happened in this country. That's not an accident. God caused it to happen. Share with you a little bit about what we do internally. Our culture at Knoxville Wholesale Furniture, and we have one, and sometimes we have to stop the bus and let people off that don't want to go with us, which we're very happy to do. Number one, we're going to start with Christian principles. Again, all of us are sinners. We're going to make mistakes. We're going to have arguments. Things are going to go wrong. But that's where we're headed. We're going to be patriotic and love the country. We're going to love our employees, and we're going to love our community. We're going to give back financially. And let me educate you on this. I thought about this a long time, and I, in the early days, gave money away. Bank taught me in one time to give money to the opera, and you may be a big opera fan, but I look back on that thinking, was I drunk? Well, the reason I did it, they had my line of credit. But I tell you, we've narrowed that down to two things. Either it's Christian-based to churches and other organizations, or it's benevolent need. That's why we give so much to Samaritan's Purse. They do benevolent need. They're down in Florida right now in Jesus' name. And Franklin Graham's incredible. I've had lunch with him a couple of times. He's even better than you think he is. First question I asked him, we took a big check up there. I said, how much do you spend on staff? He said, we cap it at 11 to 12%. If it gets to 12, we stop. And that's as good as you can do and run an organization of that size. We require, or we aspire to have, a can-do winning attitude. Oh, not just a good attitude, a can-do. That was a saying in World War II. That meant we have to, we're going to, period. Can-do winning. And we're about winning. We've won the national championship of selling more furniture in Knoxville for 25 years in a row. These incredible people, and a lot of them have been with us for 20, 25, 30 years, have created the largest independent furniture company in the Mid-South. That's based on our culture, because we didn't start with the right things that would let you do that. Can-do winning attitude, a positive confidence that affects others. And I say this all the time. When people see you coming, do they say, oh, or do they say, great? How do you affect others? And then the final one, number seven, always thankful. You know, I've noticed over the years, people that have a great attitude are thankful. It's wed together. People with a bad attitude are not thankful, if you've noticed that one. always being thankful. Tell you a little story. When the pandemic started, I was actually in Florida, and God helps me with personnel, Bunk Russell, and I had a meeting because we were on these conference calls with Ashley and different people, and it's panic central every day, and we're got to close, and oh, we're closing, they're going to make it, we got have to, oh, we're a danger to the community. And you know, we thought about it, and I prayed about it, and I thought, wait a minute. So to fix this, what we need to do is herd the whole population into Walmart upside each other, Kroger's. Dr. Fauci. Dr. Fauci got $5 million in kickbacks over the last few years from the drug companies. You'll be finding that out. And our people aren't essential. Wait, I love these people. They seem essential to me, so we said, we're not closing. And I got up in front of the company and said, we're not closing. Now, when you make a strong decision, how did we arrive at that decision? We had a firm foundation. We know what we believe. We're not looking up every day and saying, oh, what did the president say today, if you could even understand it? Or, oh, what did... No. We know what we believe. It's based on Christian principles. It's based on things I learned in coaching. We don't get up every morning rethinking. And you know what a blessing that is? It saves a lot of time. We come back. City of Knoxville's going to shut us down. We get lawyers. The city mayor and I have a great relationship. I don't come downtown and she doesn't come in my building. They came after us. Tosha came after us. We're going to declare you an unsafe workplace and shut you down. Got to understand, you make a good decision, the evildoers will come. The new Sentinel set me up and ran a front page article blasting me. I don't get the paper, so it didn't affect me too much. And then the bloggers, all of our competitors, set up these blogs, Bliss Furniture, people from, I'm not going to name anymore, I don't mind mentioning Bliss because they're on the list, but they're blogging. Tim Harris, and I'm not even going, we're in a house of worship here. They're saying things, and I'm reading that, and I'm saying, they know me pretty well. No, but they're saying the worst things. My address, go up and throw rocks through his window, attack his family, on and on, hundreds. Now, I don't do social media, but my daughter does, my wife does, Tyler does. You know, they're on there, they're seeing this, and, oh, you know, we're having employees. Have you seen this? And I'm there at the house. And, you know, business really got bad that first month, and it's bad. Here's front page article. Here's all these blogs. Here's my family saying, oh. I went out on the back. I called Bunk, and I said, Bunk, are we doing the right thing? He said, yep. I said, I thought so. And I came back in, and I said, we're staying open. Guess what God did? We had the greatest 2.5 years we've ever had. Broke every record. And we're able to give back more than we ever had. Our employees made more money than they had ever made. By staying open, we're the first ones who saw the boom. We got all that inventory brought in. We were ahead of our competitors. So sometimes if you do the right thing, you're rewarded. Now the evildoer is going to come. But you have to know what you think. If you know what you really believe, making good decisions is easy. So, what's our challenge? I want you to leave here today re-educated on how the country was founded and motivated to make a difference and decide what you really believe and influence others, wherever that may be, at your church, school, business, family, whatever it is. And thank all of you for coming. And now I want to bring up our guest speaker today, which is Glenn Jacobs, our incredible county mayor. I want to say this. There's no question in my mind God put this man here at this time. He was down in the polls his first election. They said no chance. No chance. But his people knew how great he was and actually came out to vote. And so God has allowed this man to come serve us and lead us. So Glenn, take it over.
I'm going to use this when I move around a little bit when I talk. Can I move this out of the way? No one's saying, well, someone said sure. Thank you. Appreciate that. No one's going to argue with me. Thanks. Thank you, sir. Hey, there's a couple people I want to recognize real quick. Knox County Property Assessor John Whitehead is here. And, thank you. And also Richie Beeler, who is a Knox County Commissioner, and he's on the staff here at the church. So thank you for being here. And I think that's all the elected officials that I see, but thank you all so very much for being here. Hey, can we give a round of applause for the folks that made this possible? This has been an awesome event so far. So, I guess I'm a politician now. Seriously, that really bothers me, actually. I'm not too fond of politicians. But a politician in church reminds me of a story that I heard. This politician dies and goes to heaven. And first day he's there, he gets to the pearly gates and he's talking to St. Peter. And St. Peter's like, you got a lot to learn how things work up here in heaven, but for the rest of the day, why don't you go to your house and get some rest? You have a long few days. So this limousine picks the guy up and takes him through the gold-covered streets of heaven, gets to this beautiful mansion on a golf course, just incredible. He's got a gourmet chef making him whatever food that he needs. It's amazing, right? And he says, this is heaven, is awesome, this is great. He gets up the next day, going back to the pearly gates and drive through a section of town. And these are just like, they're nice, but they're basically shacks. And you got people out there running around on bicycles. So he gets back to the pearly gates and he's like, St. Peter, I have a question. He's like, when I was coming back here, I saw this section of town. They were nice houses, but they're really small houses, and the folks that live there riding around on bicycles. And St. Peter said, yeah, that's where the preachers live. He's like, now wait a second. The preachers, they live in these two-room shacks and they ride bicycles. Meanwhile, I got a mansion and a limousine driver. How'd that happen? And St. Peter's like, well, you gotta understand. We get preachers up here all the time, but you're the first politician we've ever had in heaven. So if it's okay, I'd like to tell you all a little bit about myself and my life story. And even though my life story is unique, everyone's life story is unique, I think there are some common touch points that everyone can relate to. I was actually born in Madrid, Spain. My dad was in the Air Force. He was in the Navy during the Korean War, served on the USS Antietam aircraft carrier, was in the Navy for 10 years, switched services, was in the Air Force for 11 years. During the Vietnam War, he was a loadmaster on the C-130 cargo planes. Little while after I was born, family moved back to the States. 4 years later, Dad retired from the military, and we moved to rural Northeast Missouri. There is nothing in rural Northeast Missouri, right? I mean, nothing, okay? In fact, I grew up 5 miles outside of a town of about 300 people. Very rural area. Because of Dad's military retirement, we always had a roof over our head and always had something to eat. But if the car broke down, an unexpected expense came along, things would get pretty tough, pretty tight. Dad worked in factories. He got laid off more times than I can remember. These are the Jimmy Carter years, okay? So the country just wasn't doing that well. Mom and Dad worked really hard. Mom was a homemaker, but it just felt like we couldn't quite get ahead. And I knew that when I grew up, I never wanted to feel like my family was living paycheck to paycheck, like I sometimes felt that we were when I was a little kid. Now later, Dad got a job at the post office and was a mailman. He was a rural mail carrier. And our financial situation improved quite a bit. But those early years had profound experience on me. And financial security has always been something that's important to me. So I thought my pathway to success would be through professional sports. Okay, that's what I dreamed of being. I was a little kid. I wanted to be a St. Louis baseball Cardinal. No offense to the Cubs, because there's a Cub fan here with Commissioner Beeler. But nevertheless, I wanted to be a Cardinal, man. But there was a flaw in my plan. It was a great plan, except for the flaw in that in order to play professional baseball, you actually have to be good at baseball. And I was not good at baseball. When I was a little kid, I was tall, super clumsy, awkward. I mean, I actually got bullied in school because I was always the tallest kid, always the most awkward, the most clumsy. But then I began to grow into my body, became more coordinated, figured because of my height, I'd play basketball, might be good at that. I was pretty good at basketball. I earned a scholarship to go to a Division II school, Northeast Missouri State University, which is now Truman State University. While I was there, I got a degree in English. I wanted to teach and coach if my dreams of playing professional sports didn't work out. It turned out that I wasn't going to make it in basketball. I wasn't that good. But while I'd been in college, I put on a lot of weight and ended up playing football, switch sports. And I was naturally gifted football player. Just because, I mean, my size, athleticism from playing basketball for all those years, and it looked like I was going to play in the NFL. Had a lot of interest from pro teams, and then one day in practice, I completely blew out my left knee. I came back from that, worked really hard to get back on the field. I had to play that year because I didn't have a medical red shirt. So if I was going to play, I had to play that year. Made it through the season, kept on working hard, was not drafted, but did sign with the Chicago Bears as a free agent. Went to their rookie training camp, their rookie mini camp. I was thrilled because I was gonna get a chance to practice with the Chicago Bears to prove that I could play professional sports. The next day comes, first day you go up to the training facility and you go through all these physicals. The next day comes, no one said anything about my knee. I'm thrilled, getting off the bus. As everybody else is taken up to the practice field, I was taken to an office building where the director of player personnel told me that my knee injury precluded me from playing for the Chicago Bears, probably in the NFL, and I was given a plane ticket home. I had been there less than one day, and I was absolutely crushed because all my life, that's all I ever wanted to do. I mean, that my life revolved around sports and athletics. But after a few months of probably a depression, I got to thinking to myself that life was going to go on whether I chose to participate or not. And I could either have life completely control me and whatever happen, or I could get engaged again and I could try to take control over what I could in my own life. So I thought about my assets, a big guy, still a good athlete despite my bad knee. And didn't want to get a real job, that's actually the underlying thing for all this. So I thought professional wrestling would be perfect for me. I'd always been a bit of a fan, and I got into it. First couple years were hard. Anytime you start something new, it's difficult. But eventually, I started moving my way up through the ranks. Went to Puerto Rico and Japan and Germany, and then came here in 1995. Met my wife Crystal, who was single mom. She was working on her master's degree at ETSU, two kids, working three jobs while she's doing that. Hardest working person I've ever met in my entire life. Fell in love with this area, fell in love with her, have never left. 1997, this character Kane was created for me, and it's like my life just changed. And since then, I mean, it has been that dream that I had when I was a little kid, playing professional sports. I mean, I've been all around the world. I've been in all 50 states, 40 countries. I've entertained millions of people live and on TV, performed with some of the greatest entertainers in the entire world, been able to provide my family with a life I never thought possible, been able to do things for my community that I never would have thought possible. And when I look back on my life and I think, how is that possible for someone like me? I grew up in rural Northeast Missouri. My family didn't have nothing, okay? No money, no political connections, no business connections. How is it that I can go from there to go, I was inducted in the WWE Hall of Fame a couple years ago. How is it that I can go from there to like the top of this industry, then become mayor of the greatest place on the planet? How is that possible? And I think there's a number of things. Of course, I've been blessed. God has smiled upon my life, which is obvious. But I also think it's because I'm one of those people that Tim talked about, those billions of people who have been lifted, I wouldn't say poverty, but who have been able to improve their lot in life through the free enterprise system. It's the American dream. I'm living proof of it, okay? I mean, just wouldn't have been possible. And I've traveled the world. It is not possible in many other places for anyone to, we talk about the pursuit of happiness. It's not possible in other places for many people to fulfill their pursuit of happiness because they don't have the freedom to do that. They don't have the liberty to live their lives and utilize their gifts in a way that is fulfilling for them. The reason I got into politics is because I understand how fragile all this is, okay? Because I've lived it, and I've seen what happens in other parts of the world. And I wanna make sure that this thing we call the American dream, I wanna make sure that it's there for my kids and for my grandkids. Don't worry too much about my kids, because you know, they're old enough now, they're both in their 30s, both nurses, amazing, amazing people, but they have a voice in the public square. I don't always agree with what they say, but they do have a voice, and they are old enough that they have a little bit of control about what happens. But I have a 13-year-old granddaughter named Madison. I got a 7-year-old grandson named Cooper. They don't have any say in any of this. I mean, what happens to them? If this whole thing goes away, what happens to them? And that's a travesty. And I don't believe that people like me who have been given so much, I don't think that we can sit back and say, oh, it's okay, I got mine, while not fighting to make sure that they get the opportunity to live the life whatever way they want, but to live life that like I've been able to live and to be able to literally live out their dreams. Now, when I first got into office, I was gonna do what all good conservatives do. You keep taxes low, keep government off of our back, try to make sure that government stayed in its lane, and which to me is a very narrow lane, but stayed out of everyone's business all the time, right? Well then, March of 2019 hit, and everything just went completely haywire. The COVID-19 pandemic. Now, I'd like to be real clear about my opinions on the pandemic. First of all, I do believe that COVID-19 was a serious public health issue. There is no doubt about that. It was very dangerous. I also believe that it was used to further political agendas, and it was exploited by big government and has represented the biggest overreach of government that any of us have seen in our lifetimes. When I first heard about coronavirus, and remember, there's a difference between coronavirus and COVID-19. COVID-19 is the disease, the set of symptoms. Coronavirus is actually the virus that causes it. But I heard about it in December of the year before all this happened. You know, there was something happening in China, and I talked to public health people about it. It's like, so what's going to happen with this pandemic? Oh, it'll be like the swine flu or the bird flu. It'll be around 6 months or so. Be a pain, 6 months. What I would give for just 6 months of COVID-19 at this point, right? Then a few months later, I talked to him again. Well, I guess it was January. And said, man, this looks like it's getting out of hand in certain places around the world, especially in China. And I was told that the World Health Organization was taking a lot of criticism because they had praised China's response to the COVID-19 disease, which of course was locking down their society completely. Okay? But I was told, we can't do that in America because China is a communist country and we are not. 3 months later, we started locking down everything and doing exactly what the Chinese had done. When all that started happening back in March, of course, we're all trying to figure this out. And again, you know, I realized that coronavirus, COVID-19, was a serious issue. And the flatten the curve thing kind of made sense to me, okay? Because the flatten the curve was all about trying to make sure that the hospitals could maintain their capacity and you didn't have this huge, massive influx of sick people all at once. So that kind of made sense to me. The problem was, though, it was like, okay, this gives the hospitals time to gear up, which is a temporary measure, I understand that. But here's the problem. We went from 15 days to flatten the curve to 30 days to slow the spread. I was like, wait a second. How long do we have to live like this? Because if you stop it by no one engaging with each other, we can literally never go out in public again. And that's where we were at. I mean, seriously. And I told my people in the office, I was like, this makes no sense at this point. Okay, what we need to do, and there's actually, I don't know if you guys have seen, there was this thing called the Great Barrington Declaration, which was put forth by reputable epidemiologists, scientists, doctors, and basically talked about focused protection, which meant you focus your resources on the most vulnerable category of people, and we knew who that was. It was older folks, it was folks in the compromised immune systems. You focus the resources there, you let the rest of society do their thing, okay? That's what we needed to do. That's what I was talking about, okay? Because the problem is if you shut down society, you know, when we think about the economy, and I was accused of putting profits over people, the economy is people. We can't survive without it, okay? So we're talking about destroying the economy, we're talking about destroying jobs. We're talking about kids not going to school, so we see this learning loss and this loss of socialization, mental health, suicides, all these things that no one wanted to talk about, and people like me who did talk about it were accused of being murderers because we wanted to kill grandma. And now the amazing thing is, since everyone realizes that was a huge mistake, you have all these other people out there now saying, oh, we never did that. Yes, you did. Because I distinctly recall being called a murderer, okay? Because I was one of the few people in elected office, I believe, around the country that was saying, we cannot do this because we're going to destroy society. Yes, COVID-19 is dangerous, but the existential threat is if we lose our liberties and our freedoms. That is what will destroy this country. So that went on for a little while. I'll never forget when Deborah Birx came to Knox County. She came to the University of Tennessee. If there was, I really like President Trump, but if there was one thing that I would say, dude, you really messed up, he should have fired Fauci and Birx, like, right away, post-whip. Because the president's saying one thing, and then they're saying something else, and the media's listening to them and portraying the president as, again, as the person who wants to murder everybody. Okay, so anyway, Birx comes to TV, and actually, if any of you guys have read Dr. Scott Atlas's book, Birx was the actual architect, okay? Fauci was the face of the COVID response. Birx was the architect. So she comes to the University of Tennessee, and we're in a room as big as this, probably like 30 people. We're all sitting with as far apart as possible, all wearing masks, right? And she's giving advice, like she's come down off the mountain like Moses with the commandments, right? So she's giving advice, and one of the things that she says is that we need to close all the restaurants and bars in Knox County. And to their credit, one of the other people in the room said, well, Dr. Birx, the data shows that the virus is not spread at restaurants and bars. And she says, yes, I know, but this is about telling people, this is about sending a message how dangerous this situation is. So I'm like, wait a second. I'm sitting in a room, like 35 feet apart from everybody. I can't hear them because they're all wearing masks. Everyone in the room, except for me, has an MD or PhD after their name, and you're saying that we're not taking it seriously. She was an idiot. I don't know how to say it other than that. Okay, and these are the people that we're advising on how to handle this crisis. And they dadgum near destroyed this country by doing that. Okay, so you think, well, the pandemic's behind us now. Okay, we're through that. Yes, I think we are, for the most part. The problem is the degradation of the protections that we enjoy as Americans of our Bill of Rights have been obliterated now. Because what they showed was, in a crisis, the Constitution doesn't matter, and the Bill of Rights don't matter, and government can do anything it wants, okay? The reason that you can't shut down businesses like that is because we have a Fifth Amendment and a 14th Amendment, both of which say you have due process. And if you want to shut down a business for health reasons, you actually have to literally have to sue the business, okay? You have to say, we're going to shut you down. This is the reason why. You have an opportunity to remedy that, and then you have an opportunity to appeal that. But you can't just blanket shut down businesses in the United States of America. We have the Fourth Amendment, which says unless there is probable cause that you have done something wrong, you shouldn't have to interact with the police. Okay? That whole thing about searches and seizures, that also implies we have the right to travel unmolested by the authorities. We had states around the country putting safer at home orders, saying that people literally couldn't, what country were we living in that people couldn't leave their homes because some idiot in some Capitol building thought that that was a good idea? But we have literally codified that now. So what happens when the next emergency comes along? It's the same deal, people. They will point back to the pandemic. In fact, they already do it. And you know what the next big one is? The next big one is climate change. And it's already happening, okay? Look at what's going on in California. We're gonna outlaw gas vehicles. We want everybody to drive electric. And then like 3 days later, like, oh yeah, you can't charge your electric car because our grid stinks and we can't charge them. What in the world? What in the world are we doing? You know, California is now marketing itself as a sanctuary for abortion. What are we doing in this country? And you may think, well, that's California. That ain't Tennessee. Thank God. That's true to an extent. But the problem is, it's here as well. When Roe v. Wade was overturned, Tim was going to tell you his story. I got a pretty good one, too. When Roe v. Wade was overturned, I was actually at the beach with my family. And, of course, that was kind of a big deal for our entire country, for the conservative movement, of course, for the pro-life movement. I couldn't do anything about it anyway. But, you know, so I put out a tweet, actually pretty innocuous. From a constitutional perspective, the court was exactly right, okay? The Constitution does not mention abortion. Therefore, it is under the purview of the states, according to the 10th Amendment. Not that anyone cares about that stuff. But in any case, so I put out a tweet saying, you know, that the court made the right decision constitutionally. It's a state issue. And now states like Tennessee can put in stronger protections for the unborn. Okay? I didn't call anyone evil. Didn't call anyone terrible people. Man, like, same deal. On the internet, you got people saying that, hey, let's go to Kane's house. Let's go to Burchett's house. And we're going to stand out in front of their house on the sidewalk and protest. And you know they got sidewalks because they're really rich and they live in exclusive neighborhoods. So here's the deal. I live on a private road, not because it's an exclusive neighborhood, because the road isn't up to county standards. Okay, it's not that good. Okay, two people can't pass at the same time. But I live on a private road with no trespassing signs in Halls Crossroads, Tennessee. Please come out and make a scene at my house. But then a few weeks later, there was a protest, Market Square. And someone sent me a picture of a sign that a woman is holding. And this sign said, forgive me for saying this in church, but this sign said, if God is allowed to kill his only son, why shouldn't he be allowed to kill yours? And that's when I realized that I don't have nothing in common with those people anymore. You know, pro-choice people used to say abortion should be safe, legal, but rare. I don't know that there are any pro-choice people left now. They are pro-abortion, which means they want to kill kids. And it's horrible. And it's terrible. It's about killing. You know, all the arguments that I understand, don't agree with, but I understand, you know, the kind of pro-choice argument. I don't understand the pro-abortion arguments. I don't. Because we're just talking about killing kids. Like Tim said, I mean, they're literally now talking about post-birth abortion. I got a name for that. It's murder. You know, we can change the semantics all you want. It's still murder. But that's where we're at in this country. Okay? They're here. They're not just out there. They are here. It is here in our community. And I get to see it all the time in the mayor's office. Some of the stuff that we have to deal with, or some of the stuff that I hear about, I'm like, I can't believe this is happening in Knox County, but it is. There's something else that's disturbing about that sign to me. It's the fact that you're drawing a moral equivalency between mankind and God. If it's not wrong for God, well, why is it wrong for human beings? And it's like Charlie Kirk said, it's because we ain't God. That's why. But that's what the left wants. God has always been the enemy of communism. And the reason is because there cannot be anything above the earthly authorities. This country is founded on the notion, on the idea, more than notion, on the idea, on the principle, that there is something higher. There's a law higher than man's law. Yeah. Okay. In fact, we're all supposed to answer that. Even the people that enforce our laws have to answer to God's law. Well, if you replace God with man, you got it made. You're the ultimate authority, the ultimate decision maker. And then, of course, though, instead of being fixed and immutable, those laws are arbitrary and capricious. But that's what we've seen in every country around the world where this horrible experiment, communism, really, collectivism has been tried, is that God is replaced by man and the church is replaced by government. And that's what they want in this country. And they're moving in that direction. And we cannot allow that to happen. See, I'm not a biblical scholar, I'm not a theologian, but it's pretty much agreed upon that we're all made in God's image, right? Right? Well, what does that mean? God is not a natural being. I think what it means is we were given free will to make decisions. We are the only creature on this planet that has that. That's why we have dominion over everything else. Our freedom, our liberty is a gift from the Almighty. And the Almighty expects us to protect that. If you read the Declaration of Independence, Thomas Jefferson twice says that when a government becomes tyrannical, the people have the right to throw it off. But the second time he says that, he says they have the right, they have the duty. Why does he say the duty? Because tyranny is an affront to God, because it robs us of a precious gift, our free will. Same thing, you know, the saying, rebellion against tyrants is obedience to God. That almost became our national motto. I wish it would have. It means the same thing. Our free will, our freedom, our liberty, our ability to make decisions, to live the life that we want to live is given to us by God. And when man takes that away from us, it is an affront to him. So I believe as Christians, we have a responsibility to protect our freedom, our liberty, and those of our neighbors and our families. I think that's actually one of the most important things at this point in time that we can do. And you can say, well, you know, God's going to take care of this whole thing. His kingdom is on this earth. That is true. But if you look at, as Tim said, the Bible has been spread because of the freedom in this country. How can people choose God if they're not allowed to make choices? If they live under tyranny, they can't. They couldn't in the Soviet Union. They can't in China. Or it's very difficult. So I believe that it's actually our responsibility as Christians to defend the freedom and liberty of our fellow human beings. And that is under attack in this country. There's no doubt about it, okay? So I don't know that we can change the course of America. It's a big lift, okay? I don't know what California's gonna do. I don't really care. Not a big fan. I don't know what New York is going to do. But I know what we can do here in Tennessee. In fact, if you ask me, Tennessee is what America should be. And I think as we move forward, that's going to become more and more evident as we see these differences between states and parts of our country become more and more prominent, okay? In the last election in August, our voting was down 30% from when I ran for office in 2018, okay? That's one thing that people can do, is you can become involved in the political process, and it's really, really easy, okay? There are other things you can do as well to influence your family, your friends, and the people around you. And I think that we have to do that. Look, we may not have the biggest cities, we may not have Ivy League institutions, thank goodness for that. We don't have the New York Stock Exchange, but we got something here in Tennessee that the brightest lights in the biggest city can't hold a candle to. We still believe in America, and we still believe in the American dream, but it is up to us to make sure that continues, and it has to, because I got two little grandkids who are depending on all of you. Thank you all very much for having me here today. Thank you for this wonderful event.
A couple other things we'd like to do. Jeff, you and Mike, come forward. Tyler. We've been lucky to drive across town to attend this church because sometimes in West Knoxville, they won't tell it like it really is. And we want to do something special. We've helped the church, but Brother Mike was a big part of Real Evangelism, which I was the chairman of the board, Bailey Smith Ministries there at the end, and we love him, and somehow he found his way to this church. How lucky you
Praise
are.
Praise the Lord.
And this choir and Mike and what they do would make all of them in West Knoxville blush and be ashamed. They are fabulous. And so we wanted to present them with a check today for $40,000.
Oh, yeah.
And let them do whatever that they need to do. Thank you. So we wanted to do that. So thank you all very much. We wanted to close this out. Larry, come forward. Larry Smith, owner of Barcalounger, is here today, and he's the finest Christian man I know in the furniture industry. And so I wanted him to close this out. And he is a fabulous friend. I want to say this. We will have a table as you go out if you need to register to vote. And we've got to register by the 11th, okay? So don't be ashamed. If you haven't voted, that's fine. But get active because it matters. We all have to be influenced, okay?
And that table's right over there.
Okay. Right out that door. Larry? Close us out.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Tim. You know, Mike, I don't know where your choir is, but are they out here? Is the choir out here? Can you just raise your hand if you're in the choir? Hey, I want to say not only from myself, but everyone that's in attendance here, thank you for igniting our hearts and our souls. You ignited us with, as you ushered us with songs of worship and praise for the Lord, but you also deepened and refreshed my spirit in love of country with those beautiful and wonderful patriotic songs. So thank you. I want to say I listened to you, Mayor. Mike, we listened to your message, and Brother Tim, to yours. And if there is anything that I'm leaving here today with, it is a crystal clear message that we are to be men and women of action. I think it's fair for us to say that we have been encouraged, we have been challenged, we have been inspired, and frankly, today we have been taught, and I am profoundly grateful for that. But I also realized, Tim, in leaving today, that you men have charged each of us with an incredible responsibility, but also an incredible opportunity that we could be men and women that could model what you're teaching, what you're reminding us of, that we can be men and women that could be voices and actions and conduct of influence. And so thank you for this remarkable teaching moment today. And if you would join me as we give honor and praise to our Lord and Savior and Heavenly Father, but this tangible expression called an applause, we want to thank the choir. We want to thank each of you men who have taught us today. Can we just stand together and thank them? Father, this is for you. This is your praise, Lord. I don't know if you would be willing to do this, but would you remain standing with me? If you are comfortable, would you, one of three things, as an expression of a combined sense of unity, would you either touch your neighbor's elbow or put a hand on their shoulder, or if you're bold and courage enough, can you grab their hand? Listen, we gather in unity today, but when we leave this place, the message for each of us is crystal clear. We are to be men and women of action. Let's bow our heads and go before our Lord. Almighty God, magnificent, loving, and gracious Heavenly Father, how good you are. We worship you and we thank you. But Father, we need you. We look to you and we look to your living word to teach, guide, direct, and correct our walk and talk as we are ambassadors for your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We hold on to and we rest in your unchanging promises and steadfast faithfulness that endures to all generations. Thank you, Father, that you did not give us a spirit of timidity, but God, you gave us a spirit of power and of love and of self-discipline. Daily as we walk our faith of trust and as it grows, God, teach us to live out, as James said in chapter 2, verse 18. But someone will say, you have faith and I have deeds. Show me your faith without deeds, and I will show you my faith with my deeds. Almighty God, increase the portion of our trust and courage that we may live fearless in the face of enlarging worldly challenges and obstacles. For greater are you that is in us than he that is in the world. And may our walk and our talk truly be the light of the world. And in Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people said, amen. Amen. Thank you so much, and have a wonderful day.